I mean, they're called the killers for a reason.
Was outside your house today. I haven't seen you.
The album Hot Fuss was the debut album of American rock band The Killers. It was released in 2004 and instantly became a smash hit, going triple platinum in the US, along with 7 times platinum in the UK. Which is to say nothing of the album's critical acclaim, picking up 5 Grammy nominations and being considered by many the greatest debut album of all time.
Also, the album's most memorable song, Mr. Brightside, refuses to leave the charts. Like, it's been 14 years. The song will not go away. However, despite all the acclaim, no one seems to be praising or even acknowledging what this album really is. A concept album that details the murder of a young woman named Jenny. Alright, before we unpack that can of worms, let's review what a concept album actually is.
A concept album is described as an album that consists of a group of songs that are unified by a theme or by a certain narrative. So concept albums can be separated into 2 criteria, story and theme. For example, Pink Floyd's groundbreaking album The Wall fits perfectly into the story aspect of a concept album, detailing the life of a man named Pink who grows closer and closer to insanity with each song. On the other hand, Stefan Stevens' album, Illinois, which doesn't tell a story so much as attempt to break down and create a feeling reminiscent of its subject matter, in this case, the state of Illinois, can be categorized on the theme side of the spectrum. However, that isn't to say that albums can't have songs with stories. Craig Finn's album, We All Want the Same Things, was acclaimed for its storytelling ability. But the reason why it isn't a concept album is because there are no greater stories or themes connecting the individual songs together.
Now that we know what a concept album is, let's break down why the album Hot Fuss should be considered a concept album.
But before we jump in, let's set the stage. Hot Fuss takes place in a town in either Nevada or Utah, which can be assumed because this is where lead singer Brandon Flowers grew up, and a lot of the songs on the album, and most killer songs in general, were influenced by his own life. Now, Hot Fuss has 3 main characters, and 4 of whom are mentioned specifically by name. Our first main character and narrator for most of the songs is Mr. Brightside. He's kind of a loner, he doesn't get along with most people, he can be extremely jealous, and he's gay. This is an important note because this is where most of his conflict stems from. He's first mentioned by name in the song Mr. Brightside, however, it is a nickname that he gives himself, not his actual name. We don't know his actual name. Our second main character is Andy, first mentioned in the song Andy, You're a Star. Andy is the stereotypical high school jock from a small town. He is who everyone respects and wants to be. The town absolutely loves Andy, and this is important to note. But interestingly enough, Andy has a lot of insecurities which stem from this fact. He doubles as our second narrator and starts the story dating our woman of the hour, Jenny. Jenny is our final main character. She is upbeat, bubbly, and extroverted. Everything that Mr. Brightside isn't. And at the end of it all, she gets murdered. That sucks. She's first mentioned in the album's opener, Jenny Was a Friend of Mine. There's also a 4th character named Natalie, but she isn't very important and is only mentioned once. All you really need to know about her is that she's either Mr. Brightside's close friend or his older sister. An interesting side note is that the chronological order of the story and the album's tracklist are not the same, but this is common in most concept albums.
Alright, now that we've finally got all that out of the way, let's finally start analyzing this album. This song is very expositional and have a lot of details that remain very important throughout the entirety of the album. So let's break this thing down lyric by lyric.
This song starts off with a blaring post-punk guitar, which is perfect for the song's angsty atmosphere. After that, we move into the lyrics.
On the field, I remember you were incredible. Hey, shut up, hey, shut up, yeah.
This lyric establishes that Andy is a football player by saying, on the field. It also remarks that Andy is very good at what he does. What's interesting about this lyric, though, is that the I remember you were incredible. This is from the perspective of the narrator, and the narrator admires him very much, but Based on what we know about the narrator, his very aggressive nature, the hey shut up, yeah, only further enforces this. On the mats with the boys, you think you're alone with the pain that you drain from love. After another reference to Andy playing football, we get the line, you think you're alone, meaning that the narrator doesn't actually talk to Andy. He just admires him from afar. The second half of this line is very interesting, though, with the pain that you drain from love. This is, in fact, the first reference, albeit minor, that we get to Andy's insecurities, meaning that while the town loves him, he feels nothing but pain from that. He feels the pain of heightened expectations and the fear that he won't meet those expectations. In a car with a girl, promise me she's not your world, 'cause I'm the star. This is the first hint of just how jealous our narrator can get. He doesn't know who this girl is, he's just infuriated with the fact that this girl might be Andy's girlfriend. Because in our narrator's mind, there is no one else as good as Andy. Looking at the lyric, 'cause Andy, you're a star, basically implying that there's no one else better than him, and that no one else deserves him. Side note, this is our first reference of Jenny, although it's not by name, and she won't be referenced by name until much, much later in the story. Leave your number on the locker and I'll give you a call. Hey, shut up, yeah. After this lyric, we can infer that Andy and our narrator have started talking. Not a lot, but they have. However, our narrator is still keeping up his very aggressive nature, looking at the hey, shut ups that follow. Leave your legacy in gold on the plaques that line the hall. It's here we see how respected and important to the town Andy is, leaving his legacy in gold. He's really good at playing football, but this also leads into his major insecurities about his talent. In a car with a girl, promise me she's not your world, 'cause Andy, you're a star. And as we enter the chorus for the final time, we hit the nail in the coffin. While our narrator is still jealous of this girl, we get why he's really jealous. It's not that he thinks Andy is better than everyone else, while he does, it's that he thinks that nobody sees Andy like he does. Nobody understands Andy like he does. It is only our narrator who really gets him. If the last song gave us a taste of our narrator's jealousy, this song punches us in the face with it. What's interesting about this song, though, is that it's always been assumed that our narrator is jealous of a guy because he's with a girl that our narrator wants to be with. But pronouns here are never specified, and what's interesting is that this entire album kind of messes around with pronouns. It'll do this in a later song especially, but this is what makes most people think that this album might have a lot more LGBT undertones than one might initially think. Coming out of my cage and I've been doing just fine. Gotta be down because I want it all. He's clearly not fine, but for his own sake, he has to pretend to be. He could be in the closet because, remember, this is a very small town and most people probably wouldn't accept him. And the line, he wants it all, is the reason why he's hiding. Started out with a kiss, added it in a black dance. It was only a kiss. Okay, so Andy and our narrator have kissed, but our narrator is downplaying it in his mind because he knows Andy has a girlfriend and also out of fear. Andy is still very much with Jenny, and this hurts our narrator to know that he's second best. Because of his jealous nature, he wants to be first or nothing. This is our first big reference of our narrator's jealousy, and when he says turning saints into the sea, he means it's turning him into a bad person. Which, side note, is foreshadowing for Jenny's death. Swimming through sick love, boys, choking on your eyes. choking on your alibi means that our narrator is struggling to deal with Andy's town darling persona, and it physically pains him to have to keep this part of himself a secret. But it's just the price I pay. The price I pay is a reference to our narrator's internalized homophobia from living in such a small town. He feels ashamed of himself. He feels as if it's his destiny to suffer. Open up my eager eyes, 'cause I missed a bright side. And this is the first time that our narrator refers to himself as Mr. Brightside. And what this means is that bad things always happen to him, and he has to continuously put up this front that he's okay. Moving away from Mr. Brightside, this song focuses much more on Andy and Jenny, specifically about Andy's insecurities. Andy is confused about these newfound revelations about his sexuality, because he still wants to be seen as this respected person of the town, and he knows he won't if he comes out. And this lyric here is his internal monologue telling himself, you've only got one life, so stop lying to yourself and everybody else around you. Andy is growing up and dealing with all that encompasses, and Jenny doesn't know how to help him. She won't get it until much, much later. Because keep in mind, right now, she doesn't know that Andy's struggling with his sexuality. Him and Jenny have broken up at this point due to Jenny not understanding how to help Andy. And despite his newfound revelations about his sexuality, he still very much has feelings for Jenny, and he doesn't know what to do without her. This becomes very important later on. This is Andy's attempt at putting on a brave face. Andy is suffering just as much as Mr. Brightside is. This song is where Mr. Brightside confronts Andy after him and Jenny have broken up and convinces him that they should be together. Despite Andy's lingering feelings for Jenny and his anxiety of how the town will see him. What's interesting about this song, though, is that it switches perspectives between Mr. Brightside and Andy. This song is like a conversation. The song starts off from Mr. Brightside's perspective. He's confused as to what's going on between him and Andy right now. He knows that Andy is sort of hesitant to be with him because of his anxiety and the fact that he just broke up with Jenny, but he can't help but want to be with him. So if the answer is no, can I change your mind? Mr. Brightside is directly asking Andy that if the answer is no and Andy rejects him, if there's any way that Mr. Brightside can change Andy's mind. A siren screams at 10:30 and you This next part is from Andy's perspective, and the siren that he's speaking of is Mr. Brightside, because Andy is still struggling to come to terms with his sexuality. By comparing it to a siren, Andy is implying that these feelings are a dangerous desire. By saying he won't let go, Andy is referencing that these feelings won't go away. Because Andy's fear of what the town will think of him, he would rather ignore him and Mr. Brightside's mutual feelings for each other rather than be happy. We're all the same. And love is blind. This is Mr. Brightside comforting Andy about his sexuality by saying that we're all people, we're all human. And it is this that eventually calms Andy enough to comply to Mr. Brightside, and after this, they end up being together. Alright, so this next song is literally just a sexual innuendo, so I'm not gonna analyze it. I'm just gonna, like, play 5 seconds of it, and you can figure it out for yourself. It's just a shimmy and a shake, oh, I can't fake, we're on top. Okay, cool. Moving on.
Alright, so this is the penultimate song before the murder actually takes place, and everything in the song is kind of janked up, which can be attributed to the song taking place in a club, so everything's kind of hazy and nothing really makes sense. Specifically, though, not only is the perspective kind of janky, but also the gender and pronouns. When we talk about LGBT undertones, this is the song where it comes in forefront because, as you will see at the chorus, the gender and pronouns are completely messed up. We can also assume that a significant amount of time has passed because, while at the beginning of the story, these kids were right at the end of high school, and now they're in a club, and to my knowledge, most clubs don't let 17-year-olds in. All right, let's do this. Breaking my back just to know your name. 17 tracks and I've had it with this game. I'm breaking my back just to know your name. But heaven ain't close in a place like this. Anything goes, but don't blink, you might miss. Well, somebody told me you had a boyfriend who looked like a So yeah, there's a lot of angry confrontations, but you have to remember that this angry confrontation with Jenny and Mr. Brightside has to eventually lead into Mr. Brightside convincing Andy to, well, murder her. So it is my personal belief that when Jenny was confronting him, she must have said something offensive to him. Like, I personally don't think that she could have just come up to him, confronted him about Andy, and then that was that. I think that she either said something like homophobic or something just really awful to him to get him to be so mad as to convince Andy to do this. And we will see how this all plays out in the next song. It's a lot. I know what you want.
So these next two songs are what happens after Mr. Brightside and Andy commit the murder, and each of them focus on the other person. So this song, Believe Me, Natalie, focuses on Mr. Brightside. And while there isn't as much here to analyze, basically all you really need to know is that Mr. Brightside does in fact feel guilty, or at least he's scared as to what's going to happen to him. He knows he did something bad, and when he's talking to his older sister or a close friend, Natalie, he's basically asking her to hang out with him and do everything with him right now because he knows that he doesn't have much left, because he either has to hit the road and get out of town, or he's going to get found out by the police and whatever happens to him then happens. But it is good to know that he's not entirely a bad person. He does feel some sort of remorse for his actions. When there's nowhere else to run. All right, so this song is Andy's deal with trauma song, and it's much more on the nose and introspective than Mr. Brightside's because it ties in a lot of themes that he had been dealing with throughout the entirety of the album, such as themes of growing up and coming to terms with his sexuality and his fear of not being perfect.
Andy is transitioning from high school to the rest of his life, and he's confused and afraid, and on top of that, he's just murdered someone. He is so frustrated and upset that he genuinely doesn't know where to go. When we look at the lines, you know, no, you don't, he's just so frustrated that he can't even describe what is happening to him. He can't put it into words. He still wants to be seen as the pride of the town, but after all these things that he's done, he knows that he can never go back to that. I got soul, but I'm not a soldier. 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 What Andy means here is that even after all of these awful, horrible acts that he's committed, he's still a human being. He's not who everyone wants him to be, but he's still a person.
Jenny was a friend of mine, the penultimate song in our story, but actually the opening song on the actual album. This song is about people from the town being questioned about the murder of Jenny, because, of course, people would find out about that. And in a similar pattern to Change Your Mind, it switches back and forth between Andy and Mr. Brightside's perspective. We took a walk that night, but it wasn't the same.
It's interesting to note Andy felt very guilty, and it clearly showed in how he was talking, while Mr. Brightside insisted that he had nothing to do with it and just wanted to get out of there. After this song, Mr. Brightside jumps town. He's gone. No one basically ever sees him again, while Andy either stays in town or does get arrested for this crime. It's kind of open-ended as to what happens to him.
And with that, we reach the final song on the album, Everything Will Be Alright, a bittersweet ballad to send off a tragic story. This final song is from Andy's perspective, and this is after Mr. Brightside has left town. Andy doesn't forgive Mr. Brightside for all the things that he did and the things that he encouraged Andy to do, but At the same time, Mr. Brightside was the only person that Andy found comfort in when dealing with his sexuality. He was the only person that knew the struggles that Andy was going through, and in a weird way, Andy's kind of nostalgic for the times that he spent with Mr. Brightside. Andy is upset with Mr. Brightside leaving. While he's happy he's gone, he realizes now that the extent of his feelings for Mr. Brightside went a lot deeper than he initially thought, and with him gone, he doesn't know how to cope with it. However, despite all this hurt, Andy proclaims, and that's it. That is the entire story of the Killers album, Hot Fuss. It perfectly fits into the idea of a concept album, with themes of jealousy, sexuality, dealing with changes, and learning how to grow up, but also with the story side. And while it might seem like a stretch or that I'm thinking too much about all of this, I'm not the first person to notice these connections. Vice offshoot Noisy posted an article about the same, albeit differently arranged, concept. And the Killer's Murder Trilogy has been talked about since practically the album's release, which is a similar version of the story that I told in three songs instead of a whole album. And this Murder Trilogy, as dubbed by fans, was intentional by lead singer Brandon Flowers. So who's to say the band didn't accidentally do this with the whole album? Brandon Flowers is known for his storytelling ability and interest in dark subjects. Just take a look at the song Uncle Johnny about Flowers' own drug-abusing uncle and the song Where Is She about an actual controversial murder that took place in Scotland. A band with a flair for the dramatics like the Killers seems like the perfect candidate for crafting such a story. Plus, isn't it much more fun to see this album as more than just a pop album? Rather, a tragic tale dealing with themes like jealousy, sexuality, and change? Real or not, by looking at the Killers album Hot Fuss like this, it can open up one's mind to all the different stories that other albums could be telling, but you just might not be realizing. So while I did this with Hot Fuss, I encourage people to go out and look at other albums and see all the different stories that they might be telling under a few lyrics.